Hello, everybody. Welcome back, and thanks for tuning in to Price Links. My name is Phil Flynn. I'm senior market analyst at the Price Futures Group, as well as a Fox Business Network contributor. Today, we have a very special man from the Price Group, an industry veteran, the guy who called the said that interest rates would go to zero well before anybody believed it's possible, the ag master, the man who deals with cattle, hogs. Well, he's not the ag master, but he knows all of this stuff. He's been around for a long time. John, it's good to have you here today.
Thanks, Phil. It's great to be
you
here.
You know, John, you've been telling me that you're really here. You spend a lot of time in Arizona, but you're
right.
Really here to check on the crops, and you want to really, you think this is a significant time in the ag markets.
Oh, yeah, I do. I think we're in a transitional period where we've had these expansion of prices in all of the grain markets as well as the meat markets, and now it's a matter of whether we're going to stay here, go backwards, or go even higher than where we are.
Now, based on the recent market activity that you were talking yesterday, that a lot of people get false impressions of price. When you have a big rally, they like to buy it all the way down because they think it's going to get back to that price. Do you see that happening now?
Absolutely. That's continuing to happen because the bias in all these markets has been up over the past 4 or 5 years. Each of them seems to have corrected over that period of time. Yet because we set new highs, those new highs are now the new bar.
Right.
So when a person looks at gold at $1,300 an ounce and says, gosh, should I buy it as an investment? They're looking at the $1,900 high thinking it's going to go back there rather than thinking, well, perhaps before I buy it, it may retest that 30-year price range and go back toward $850 or $900.
Mm-hmm.
So in the agricultural business, because we had such a bad problem last summer with the weather, it's a matter of can we replenish those crops?
Right.
You know, if you look at the third world crops, the sugar, coffee, cocoa, those markets exploded in 2007, 2008, and 2009. All of them have retraced back. We traded coffee as high as $3.35 20 years ago. We did it again 4 years ago. Starbucks has raised the price every time along the way, as has Folgers and every other manufacturer, yet the wholesale price now is $1.30, $1.35. We're back in the middle of the range. The question now is, with the expansion of the economy, the recovery of the economy, particularly in the United States, the rest of the world's still struggling a bit. We've had a lot of sales of equipment. We've had all the agricultural world get better, feel good. Land prices have gone through the moon. Relying now on, does $5 corn really look bad?
Mm-hmm.
But if $5 corn is going to be the low, what's going to be the high? Is it going to be the low? Because we went to eight now is the new high, the new bar.
Right.
So every time somebody's buying a contract of corn, they're thinking it's going to go back to $8 again without looking at the potential production that we have.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've got the most efficient farming community on the planet right here in the United States.
We do.
A lot of that knowledge, equipment, ability has been transferred and taught to the rest of the world.
Right.
So if they have similar conditions in terms of weather, soil, etc., with the fertilizers and the equipment and the seed that we've been able to make so much money with, what's that do for production
over a
period of time?
And it's funny you bring up the fertilizer thing because that was a big news story today. You know, we had kind of a cartel when it came to the potash. You know, they broke up that cartel. A lot of people are saying that's going to mean substantially lower prices for fertilizer, at least in the near term. Is that going to lower the bar for the cost of production for grains?
Possibly, but you know, the land prices have gotten so high. So if you've held on to land for a long time, you're sitting pretty right now.
Right.
But if you're a recent buyer of land, you're relying on these most current prices to be able to make the payments on that land. So, you know, every input cost that would decline would certainly help the agricultural community. But at the same time, if the production increases, the price is going to go down. So we're still going to be in the same equation that we've been in before. It's like what's happening in the cattle market. 35 years ago, we have a cattle population of 125 million in the United States. Today, we're less than 90 million.
Mm-hmm.
35 years ago, the price range of cattle, of fat cattle, was probably 30 cents to 55 cents. We struggled in that range for almost 25 years before exploding to the current prices. Is that herd going to increase again? I don't think so. You know, they've been selling it off for a long time. So to run a cow-calf operation now is terribly expensive simply because the underlying land cost is so expensive.
Right, and not to mention the feed cost.
And perhaps the American diet is changing modestly, reducing some of that demand.
Mm-hmm.
and perhaps a 90 million population might suffice, but I don't think so.
But we're being more efficient. As you point out, we're doing better. We're producing more beef with less calf, so there's an efficiency impact here.
But we got a lot bigger animals coming out, too, though. We're selling them 1,500 pounds instead of 1,100 or 1,200 pounds.
Well, that's what
pounds.
I'm saying.
That's a significant increase in tonnage.
And, of course, you got to worry about the hormone in situation, you know, whether we'll be able to export that. That seems to be taking a side issue right now for the cattle market. But is this inevitable? I mean, after the drought, we reduced the herds, the grass-fed herds that were wiped out, basically. Is this new technology, these fatter cattle, is this just a sign, like other markets, we have found a level of efficiency and we'll never get those cattle numbers up to where they were?
Probably won't get the cattle numbers up to where they were in any, you know, reasonable period of time, just because of the life cycle.
Right.
More than likely, what's going to happen is we're going to have a continued fluctuation. When everything looks like it's going to go up and everything, all the indications are that it's going to go up, it's probably already up and it's going to go backwards.
Right.
And when everything looks the worst, we're going to, you know, think that it's going to continue to go lower and it'll stop. The grain market's an interesting example because so many people today think that prices look terrible. But only in the last 2.5 years have corn prices been even close to this level. In the entire history of mankind, they've never been here before.
And that's true, that's true. But you got to remember, never in the history of mankind have we been printing money like we have around the globe. The impact of Fed policy, not only here in the United States, you know, and we talk about these higher bars and lower bars. What impact do you think the Fed has on that higher bars and that's going to impact? And we're going to have to end it right here, so give me a quick answer.
The Fed's only in control of the short-term rate. Gotcha. Everything else is market-driven.
Really? So you don't really think that the Fed quantitative easing 1, 2, or 3 had any major impact on the cost of grains?
No.
Kind of interesting. We're going to have to come back and visit that again. But thank you so
You're
much
welcome.
For coming. Great
seeing you again.
We enjoy your knowledge, and thanks, everybody, for tuning in to Price Links.